Call to order the Sunderland School Committee meeting for September 20th, 2016. There you go. Hope everybody had a good summer. And glad to see everybody and very happy to welcome our new superintendent, Dr. Lynn Carey.
Thank you. I'm very happy to be here.
And we're thrilled to have you here and looking forward to doing lots of good work together. So, that said, jump into the minutes from June 2016. Any questions, corrections, right motion?
I have a couple questions.
Yeah, good.
Just two questions. It said there are $2,000 in unpaid cafeteria bills.
Yeah.
Did we recoup any of that at all?
I have not gone over with our cafeteria manager what was collected this summer because they just get back and they get the cafeteria. So I let them get the cafeterias up and running and I will check in with her probably next week to see what we did collect for this summer.
Okay. And what happens if we have frequent flyers?
Well, that's something that, you know, what happens is letters go home weekly. And if we have a problem, then what I do is then I send a letter home to the parent and I ask them to call me. And we make a financial arrangement, try to understand the circumstances, why this is reoccurring. A lot of times what we find, Keith, is that mom and dad will say, but I send my kid with their lunch. And it's like, well, they're either eating it on the way to school or they like what's in the cafeteria better and they're taking school lunch. And there's not much we can do about that. And so it's good conversations with parents and getting everybody on the same page. And like I said, we're very open to payment plans if parents get behind. We understand that there are circumstances and no child goes unfed. So we work on it.
Okay. And my second one was, there was like building security. If we had leftover funds, that would maybe be applied to grade one or smart board or early childhood ed. And I was wondering if we did in fact have anything left over that we did apply to that.
We did not have any funds left over, unfortunately. After we get done accruing the summer payrolls and whatnot, we did not have much left. I think we had a little bit left. And we used it to pay a partial of the smart board.
Mm-hmm. And then we used this year's funds for the early childhood learning. And we're also in the process of updating our, temporarily, our security camera system by adding a couple cameras on the west wing here. Eventually, we'll have to do a much bigger upgrade by getting an entire new system to have even more cameras.
I think that is, I do think Principal Barshevsky's right, because I'm just trying to remember. I think the repairs to get the new EC classroom took more precedent over the smart boards. So what leftover funds we did, we got the contractors in to do some work to prep the EC room, and then we used this year's money to do the smart boards.
Yep, and the new smart board did go up in the sixth grade classroom.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Anything else? A motion?
I'll make a motion to accept the minutes.
Second.
All right, thank you. All in favor? Aye. Unanimous. Okay, and Patty Kellner, our business director, will give us the financial statements.
Okay, so you have two packets in front of you. The first one says FY16, and this is how we ended the year in all of our funds. And this is what I will be using to do our end of year report, which is due to Desi at the end of September. And Mr. Fulton, as chair, you will have to sign off on that report. I will probably try to do it in October, but since that's a joint meeting, I might wait. The reports will be submitted, and your signature will just follow in November. And then you have your FY17 report, which is the months of July and August. And the teachers' pays, because they haven't started and haven't accrued yet into, encumbered into that column. So those will be done for the October reports. One of the things that Dr. Carey had suggested we do, and we are going to do our darndest to do it, is to get these reports out to you before the meeting so you have more time to look at them. I cannot promise that they'll go out with the packet, but you'll get them at least emailed to you 24 to 48 hours prior to the meeting. Dr. Lynn would like to see us make that happen, and we will do that. The third thing I gave you was an update on our school choice monies. And if you remember at budget time, I told you that we were no longer spending a year in arrears, that we were spending, you know, most of the last year's money and part of this year's money. So I gave you an update of where we are right now. So at the end of the year, we are going to have approximately $225,203.73 of the FY17 money spent. So if you look down below, our revenue would be 303,357 because they based our FY17 revenue on our ending June. That'll get adjusted in December, so that could go up, that could go down. So if we're saying there's going to be 225, that means we're going to start FY18 with only $78,000. So we really have to look at budget season moving some of these positions onto our town appropriation. We're funding classroom teachers, and we did have to, unfortunately, what is different here when you see the $17,751, we did have some move-in students that required additional IAs. So that had to get added to the budget. We did not have a choice in that matter. It was an IEP requirement. So I just wanted to bring this to you as we have updated it and let you know where we are. And we'll have further conversations about this when we get closer to budget season. Just to report.
So you're saying that 17,751 was an a recent
We had a movement over the summer. And then lastly tonight, you have seven warrants before you that total $74,103.73.
$78,153 is what we're starting, what we'll start next year with.
Right, when we really should have 303. Because we usually take our FY17 revenue, spend it in FY18, but we're spending 225 of it in 17, so we'll only have 78,000. And that number is gonna go down if our December, when DESE puts out this year's school choice numbers, that number could go even lower because if we have less school choice this year, which, you know, I can only go up what we're reporting here, but I have to wait for the financial, the final numbers from DESE, because they compute them based on the October 1st enrollments that we send them. So in December, these numbers will change.
Okay. What are we expecting in terms of that compared to a year?
According to this year's report, or the report that was just sent out, we have 46 school choice students, and compared to this time last year, we had 43.
So we're up three students, and again, what won't be computed is if any of our new students have a sped increment, because that won't be known until we file in June. So when we get our numbers in December, it'll be all of our head counts of 5,000. Plus any student we had last year with a sped increment, they give us an estimated sped increment. And that'll just be the heads that we've got, the $5,000 per head. And then we don't file the sped increment until June when they give us our finals.
So I'm just looking at, we're gonna start next year with 78,000 left over. What do we start this year with?
So that would be under the projected FY17 number. We spent already $121,996.93. We spent in 15 that much of 16's money.
Okay.
So 16's money was 303. So we actually...
Was it 253? No?
No, it was 303 when we finally ended in June. We anticipated, it was, our estimate was 253,599 in last December.
Okay.
But then when we filed in June, we got 303,357. So we actually got almost $50,000 more.
So that was good.
That's good. Right. But then after we applied on the teachers, we had the contract settlement, we had to apply those raises to the salaries, and then we had to add the one IA.
Yeah. I think this is going to be very interesting moving forward as the in-town population, the trend over the past few years is that the population in our school has gone up, you know, which would mean less students accepted school choice.
And I think, just so to further emphasize what Principal Barshevsky is saying, it's not only has our population here in Sunderland grown, but our SPED population has grown, which is a, you know, it's a costlier per student cost when they're special education.
I feel like that's a trend.
Yes.
Everywhere.
Everywhere. You're correct.
So just my question is going forward, we're going to have to move some of these salaries onto the town expenditures, and possibly that 78,153 that we're going to start next year with is going to be even less the following year.
So basically, we're changing our methodology of how we're using our school choice. Okay, so most districts spend the money in the year that they get. Here in our four communities, they decided they wanted to spend a year behind. That way, if anything changed, we would have 1 year to make the budgetary changes. So we're just changing our methodology from spending a year in arrears to almost spending the money as we earn it in the current year.
It's been up or down, but I mean, that I think that started mainly after the 2009 financial crisis and budget devastation. And so it's been more or less in this period since then. This last year obviously was a big year in that regard. We did warn, for what it's worth, the select board in our budget meeting with them last spring that this was on the horizon. I mean, we saw this coming a while ago, we were looking at it. So they do have some heads up. But it was also in the context of a relatively big increase in our budget. As we were also pointing out, our enrollment, unlike the rest of the district, our enrollment has been going up. So there's a reason that our budget is going up.
And let's not forget that our budget increase was due to the fact that we had to meet the net school spending because there were no charter and choice tuitions going out, which is good, which means our kids have come back to Sunderland to be educated here.
Right.
After the 2009 budget crisis that Mr. Fulton
where we lost a bunch of kids to choice, yeah.
So just what I'm looking at is, so we're spending a year in arrears, at least we have like a
cushion.
Yes, and so now we're kind of, we don't have a lot of wiggle room, there's no safe zone, but so instead of having to move all these expenditures here onto the town budget, like maybe in one huge swoop,
we're
going to be selectively gradually moving, and so that when we get the budget, we're going to have to start targeting which ones we can move, which year, how.
Exactly. Yeah. Right, I'm not saying the town's going to have to pick up $406,000, no, but we can't afford to carry them all here anymore, and they are essential personnel.
Yeah, we have to be very smart about how we're selecting which one gets moved in what order at what time.
Exactly. Okay. So that's what I'm saying, we need to be strategic at budget time about the decisions that we make.
I just want to make sure that you had a question earlier. I want to make sure that I did understand the answer correctly. So we're projecting, let's see, projected available in fiscal year 18 is 78,000.
Right.
And you're saying that if we went back 1 year in a time machine to this meeting, the number for 17 would have been 303,000.
Yes.
Okay. That's so, so roughly $220,000.
Correct.
Yeah. The last year, I think when we were looking at it, we weren't looking at the projected available at the end being 303. We were looking at, right, so I wouldn't compare the 303 to the 70.
That's what I want to get clarity.
Right, right.
We should have, no, we should, he's just coming at it, I think, from a different angle, and I'm just trying to look at it from him. So when we start this year, we should have the full amount of the FY16 revenue, which was 303,357. We should have that in the bank right now, but we don't. We only have 181,000.
We should, in the sense of if we want to have, be a full year behind.
Correct.
In terms of spending.
Correct.
Right. But we were not in that position last year. The beginning of last year, we were already spending.
So what was the number last year?
Some of the current years.
What was
I think it was.
In 16, are you asking me what our projection was in the 16 budget for, or the 15 budget for 16?
See where it says projected available in FY18.
Yes.
Basically the end of the year.
What was that?
If we had the same sheet from a year ago, the 18 would be a 17. And instead of 78, there would be a different number.
Correct.
What's that number?
All right.
Which I think was Keith's original question.
I don't think we did. I mean, this isn't necessarily something we've always done at
no,
the beginning
this,
of the year.
Right.
I think because you're highlighting
so
this.
We're not able to look at that and say
exactly. I can go back and calculate it.
We could.
When I saw 303 down to 78, that was alarming. But apparently that's not apples to apples.
So. Right.
Okay.
And I can go back and calculate that.
I was going for what, how selective do we need to be about moving people on to the town expenditure?
I think it was probably that 78 was probably more like 180, I'm guessing.
Yeah.
Here I'm ballparking, educated guess. So it's down, you know, we've spent, I mean, what happens is if we're spending what we, you know, if we're adding some from that next year, and then we start there, now that's in our budget, so unless we get that from somewhere else, we're carrying that to the next year, and then if we need, you know, if we're then pulling, you know, that's going to make us pull even a little bit more that next year, and we've had some years where we backed off of that a little bit, but obviously we're going to. Last year was not a year to back off of it. We had a significant increase in that I think is there's reasons for it, but at the same time, how much the town can adjust also in 1 year. So hopefully, I mean, I think we start early with them and let you know they know that this is a position that we can't be cutting it too fine because all of a sudden in the year we don't if we're doing it in the year as we're projecting to get it, those are projected numbers, you know, and yet the budget, you know, the teachers are hired or whatever else it is, it's not, we can't unspend that, so.
Part of my worry is it's a trend that has, we've been a year in arrears, but we're spending more and more in the money that we're getting this year. At some point, there's going to be a hard stop that, well, we need to start spending next year's money, and I don't want to get to that point.
No, right. you can't do that.
And I think
yeah,
that
we're stuck, so.
You can't do that.
And especially because when you're there, well, to the extent that I think districts are doing that, you know, either you have to be extremely conservative because then you're based on projections and we don't know what your final numbers are going to be, you know, or you're playing with fire. I mean, we don't want to be in that position.
The number, if we rolled this meeting back a year, that number would have been 189,943.
Feeling pretty good. Thank you. All right. So good. I think it's great that we're looking at this early. It would be great if we can do our best educated guess as we get to the budget season. Well, then we'll have the December. So if we get an update in December, you're saying, from the state? And then maybe we can do our best educated what we think it's going to end up at in June. Based on
that's
theirs, right, and then we can, you know, start having that conversation amongst ourselves and with the select board, and work on that pretty hard this year.
So, and I just want to point out, if you go to take your FY17 report, okay, and go to page 8, you will see the number is 406,564, which is exactly what this number is. So, this is your school choice budget. with the 406 that we're anticipating spending. So I just want to show you how everything ties up.
Where are we looking now? So page 8?
Page 8, yep. Your GL budget, your first column on the far left is the 406,564. Yep. That ties up to this number on our worksheet, 406,564.
Okay.
So this, when we look at this every month, this is your school choice page. So we'll be able to see how we're spending. Mm-hmm. I just wanted to give you this as an additional synopsis so that, because again, I think it's important because it, October's a joint meeting and we know sometimes we don't get to spend as much time together, all of us at the joint meetings as we wish. Sometimes it's superintendent, sometimes it's myself. So I didn't want to wait till November to bring this to you.
So these 003 numbers are all school choice?
Yes.
Can you, I don't know whether this meeting or the next one, but run us through, I know as we started doing this last year,
yes,
with the accounts broken out more, which is awesome. But if you could run us through that again. So like when you say page 8 is that school choice page essentially, and how we, when we're looking at that, like it, because the, you know, the account number is in this range.
Right.
It's, you know.
And you can see, well, if you look right there on the bottom, it says fund school choice 003, and it gives you all your totals.
Right.
And if you look on page 9, it's going to tell you fund circuit breaker 004.
Right.
So that would be our circuit breaker funds.
Okay.
Which we have done this year.
But I can tell, even at the line items, if I was like looking just at a line item, I could tell that that was coming, that was paid for from school choice, or?
Yeah, everything that starts with an 003. So everything on this page.
Yep, 003, okay. Gotcha.
The right. Only one that runs multiple pages is the 001, which is our town appropriate.
Which is the town appropriate. Perfect. So those first three numbers are the key. That's what.
And I'll give you a key.
My memory jogged on.
Okay.
Thanks.
And can I just ask about how we finished with the 16 budget? I'm going right to the last page, but. Am I reading it right? I see that we were $33,000 over.
Yes, but that's a total of all of our funds.
Right.
Okay, so if you go to the bottom of page 6, you will see we spent right to zero on our appropriation.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and then go to page 7. That was our transportation. We spent right to zero.
Okay.
Page 3 is the school choice. We overspent that by $9,000 than what we planned on.
Mm-hmm. Page 3?
Page 8.
I'm sorry, page 8. 003 is.
Oh, there we go.
So we overspent what we anticipated by $9,000. And then the circuit breaker we spent to zero. And then on our Horizons budget, we overspent $24,000, but we got revenue to cover that. So it's not like we're negative spending. We had more revenue, so we put more on this budget.
Okay.
And then the same thing with the early childhood, we spent to zero.
So when that says like the, okay, so the actual revenue that the program brings in,
we're not in a deficit.
Okay.
I don't think the revenue.
It doesn't show here.
No, it doesn't show because these are expenditure reports.
Right.
Here.
No, but I can bring you a revenue report. I can break it out so that it's its own report. So all right now this is one report, so you get all funds. But I can add revenue so that you can see the money as it's coming in. I just don't want that to confuse you because it's not fitting.
And if, okay,
so I mean, I'm not looking to unduly burden you.
Oh, it's not a burden. I just this infinite visions isn't always the most friendly thing. That's why sometimes I pop it into Excel because I think I can make it more understandable for non-accountants to understand the numbers.
So then the 90 minus 33 wound up being paid for 20 something from the Horizons revenue.
Correct.
And 9 from
school choice.
School choice.
Right.
Beyond what we
had anticipated the December before.
Yep.
So long and short of it, we came out clean after last year.
I'm happy. Alan's happy.
All right. Any other questions, comments? Thank you very much. Public comment. Come join us, folks.
Think they're all in the gym.
Yeah, getting ready for the meeting. I did try to pull in somebody who came early for the meeting, because initially I think it had been announced it to be 6 o'clock, the town meeting. I tried to get him to come to the school committee, told him it was a higher ticket, but no. Anyway, next time. All right, so then we don't have any unfinished business, so moving on to new business. Discussion on a new start time for Sunderland School Committee meetings.
What we've been doing is we're finding that 6 o'clock, particularly in the deepest part of the winter, is can be an easier time for people to come out to meetings. Frontier's changed to a 6 o'clock time, Deerfield has changed to a 6 o'clock time, Waitley is a 6 o'clock time, and particularly for Patty and me, we're going out to all of these meetings. 6 o'clock is a better time, you know, for us. And so the question before you is, how would this committee feel about changing the meeting time to 6 o'clock instead of 7 o'clock?
Okay. Discussion? More questions first? I don't know the history of, honestly, the time. It was 7 o'clock when I joined 7 years ago. And I don't know, I don't think it has been revisited, honestly, since.
Is it Sunderland and Conway that used to meet on the same night, or is that Waitley?
No, that was Waitley.
Okay, I'm
sorry. I prefer 6 anyway.
I'm certainly not opposed to starting and ending earlier. I'll show up 30 seconds plus or minus.
Someone at the Deerfield School Committee said I can come at 6:02 just as well as 7:02.
Motion
to move the start time to 6 o'clock.
Yeah.
Sounds good.
Any second on that?
Second.
Michelle. Any further discussion?
I'd like to tell you that I personally I appreciate it, and I just want to thank you.
Okay.
And Patty wants to thank you.
And thank
as well.
You too.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
It makes those long winter rides home a little shorter.
And Ben, I'm assuming not going to be a hardship for you to get
from across the bridge
to, and then yeah.
No, maybe Lynn and I can carpool it.
So
you can talk school committee.
All right, all in favor?
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
I'm interested that that didn't come up another time before. I'm not sure.
I know, because we talked about it when Superintendent Barrett was saying, you know, bringing to your attention how cumbersome
these meetings
can get for the superintendent.
Yeah, it's night after night. Yeah. No doubt. Okay. And then a delegate representative to the MASC conference. So.
Is anyone going?
I'm going.
Michelle's going, right? Yeah.
But I won't be there on Wednesday, which is the day that matters for them.
Yeah.
We needed to vote on that if you were going and have you fill this out and we sign in front of this.
Right. Yeah. I was last year, and it was fun and interesting. But this year I'm not going until Thursday morning.
Yeah. Okay.
Well, unless we added me to Wednesday, I could. Wouldn't mind, but I think we'd have to change everything as far as like night reservations and stuff.
I don't think that would be an issue if you want to go, Michelle, okay, and be the representative. I don't think that would be.
I mean, we could make you the delegate. We could make you the delegate, and then if you're interested, and then if you just don't wind up going,
right,
it's not a big deal.
Yeah.
But then we're covered if you do.
We need one. Yeah. Okay.
Let's do it. So, make a motion for Michelle Dunson to be our delegate to the MASC. A second. All right.
Keith.
All right. I thought I could make the occasional motion.
Oh, I know.
Okay. No, I know. Usually, I ask for the motion.
I ask
for a motion, which is what I usually do.
He said second.
All right. Either
okay,
way.
So
pick either
one.
Pick either one.
Okay.
I'll make a motion.
And Keith, and who's seconding? Thank you so much.
Have fun.
Hey, it was fun.
Listen, all in favor? All right. So reports. I think there have been any committee meetings, Heather. Collaborative, Michelle, starts next Wednesday.
Okay.
28th. I'll send you some.
Where is that held?
So it's every other month, and it rotates between the Northampton, where their offices are,
okay,
and somewhere in Franklin County. Most recently, it's been in Greenfield at the transportation, the new transportation building there, downtown Greenfield. I'm not sure if that's going to continue to be the location for Franklin. And I'm
do
not
you
sure.
Time? So we September. Don't know how.
So they start at 6:30. There's food at 6.
Okay.
The meeting starts at 6:30.
Okay. And so will I get an email? How am I going to be?
Yeah, I'll make sure that they have your email address.
Okay. So we're talking
for them.
Wednesday the 20th.
They haven't actually sent out this packet or anything like that, unless they've taken me off that list, but I don't think they have it for that meeting, but I looked up from something that was sent out over the summer.
Okay. I do have a scheduling conflict. How imperative is it that I'm there?
If you miss that, I mean, it's going to be, at some point it's your first September meetings. Probably, if you're going to miss one, that's not a terrible one to miss. I don't know if they've gotten to where they've talked about having something where if you miss two in a row, then you have to make it to the next two in a row to have a vote
right.
again or something like that.
Right.
And they let people know when they're worried about a quorum, and you can see the agendas and things like that.
Right.
In terms of what's going
How
on.
Long do they typically last?
Oh,
it starts
about
at 6?
15, 20 minutes.
Oh, really?
No.
I'm like, really? Because I could pop in for that and then swing over, but.
Isn't that what I said when I got
yeah,
to
right?
take it over? A couple, you know, they're honestly 2 to 2.5 hours.
Okay.
I think they put a cap of like 9 o'clock on them. But, you know, because I think that's the compromise of meeting every other
right.
Month that they wind up being relatively long, and I mean, there have been some things that help, like why am I blanking on this word? When grievances used to come to the full board, and now there's it's going to be and there's some things to take some things that really probably don't need, you know, that are lengthening the meetings that don't need to come to the full board unless. You know, a subcommittee would say
okay.
that this needs to go to the full board.
Gotcha.
So, and then we can talk offline too a little bit more about the collaborative.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yep. All right. Principal Barshevsky.
Great.
Beautiful.
Welcome, everyone.
So Sunderland was very busy over the summer, especially due to the Deerfield roof project. We were host to a number of the summer programs, including the River Valley Day Camp, Math Camp, and Reading Camp, in addition to our Horizons program, which is here every summer as it is. As far as building maintenance is concerned, really our main big project was the early childhood extended learning classroom. We have plumbing work, electrical work, carpentry work done in there, padded tile floors, added a second toilet, added a second seat. The plumbing for that already existed. It was an existing bathroom. We just had to purchase a couple new appliances there. The room looks great, and it's being used on a daily basis all day long. And the purpose of making this extended classroom was for some of our preschool kiddos who did need a full-day program. So instead of sending them out to other districts and potentially losing them later on, we're keeping them in-house. So there's some cost up front to that now, but I think it's going to end up being worthwhile in the long run, for sure.
So we have some that are going full-day now?
We have five students who are here for the full-day program. Yeah. Nice. And the back room, it's kind of a revolving door. So some of the students are in the general ed classroom, and then a number of the regular ed students with some of the full-day kiddos go back there as a learning space. And then it's used as a rest area in the middle of the day for them as well. At this time last year, our opening day enrollment was 232 students. Now it's 259. We did not have an increase of 27 students over the summer. A number of students came in throughout last school year as well. So this is primarily kids just moving into our district. And as you can see, we also have an increase from this time last year, from 43 to 46 school choice students. We had a number of staffing changes and new hires over the summer as well. Alicia Reed moved from a second grade teacher to a first grade teacher. Ryan Copeland is our new sixth grade teacher. Kelsey Fluitt is our morning preschool teacher. Karen Johnson, physical therapist. Susan Hawkins, instructional assistant. Aaron Sears, instructional assistant. Kelly Murphy, speech and language pathologist assistant. Chris Williams is our long-term PE sub for Ms. Jibo, who's on maternity leave until the end of October. Samantha Marsh is our new third grade teacher. Mary Jo Sherrill is our district strings teacher. Elise Budazuski, Rebecca Robert, and Kaura Toyota are all new instructional assistants as well. So we welcome many new faces, both students and staff, to our building this year.
By the time we meet again, this both people will be going.
Yes, and so thank you for that. She'll be gone at the end of October.
Oh, I thought it was September.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
So our fourth grade teacher, Peggy Bolte, is retiring at the end of October. And you notice the two classroom teachers, Samantha Marsh and Ryan Copeland. One is for Peggy's retirement, and the second is because we had one sixth grade class leaving last year and two kindergarten classes coming in, so we need to add that position as well.
Patty just reminded me and asked me to remind to say this, that we are at capacity in our early childhood program, and now Sunderland is sending their students out to the other schools in Union 38. So it's very popular.
Right.
So the 26 is our max?
That's where max
and
out.
So okay.
Anybody else coming to Sunderland would have to go to one of our other programs.
The max is closer to 30, but the 26, some of those students are the full day kiddos,
right,
so they
right,
would
right.
be on the more the AM
right, right.
and the PM.
So it winds up being effectively
right.
30. Yeah. Gotcha.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, that's good news, bad news, right?
Yeah.
It's
kind of
It's overall, yeah, overall,
so
it's
a great thing. So even with all that we've added, that Principal Barshevsky and Kim McCarthy are bored, after all we've added, we still have an overflow.
Yeah.
So the kids are still going to be coming.
Yeah.
Even though everyone tells us they're going to have a population decrease, we're not seeing it here in Sunderland.
Ben, you got 255?
Yes, and so the variance from the report that was sent out in my report, we switched to a new student information system over the summer, and what happened, some of the students in the district ended up on the rosters at other schools. So since school has started, those students have been switched back over to Sunderland.
It's just clerical.
Just clerical, yeah.
Any idea off the top of your head what we ended with last year? I know it's a little different because we have sixth grade going out, but so we started 232 last year, but ended more.
The number 240 sounds very familiar.
Okay.
Let me see if I can pull it up.
Did we have the number come in over the summer?
We had a number of new kids moving over the summer. We had 30 sixth graders leave. We have 38 kindergartners now, so there's eight of the students right there.
I have May's enrollment. In May, we were at 239.
So even from the end of last year, yes.
So you guys have good estimates.
Yeah. Feeling dogs and I there. So. In addition, I want to bring everyone up to speed of a small issue we've been dealing with since last Thursday. Last Thursday, two bugs, what were suspected to be bed bugs, were found on the hat of one of our students. So we collected the specimens, bagged them up, and alerted families in that classroom along with the classrooms where siblings are in the school as well. We alerted families by sending home letters. Following the discovery of the bugs, we contacted the local Board of Health, who referred us to Hillside Environmental, which is the health agent for the town of Sunderland. Health agents, they represent the smaller towns. They asked us to contact a local pest control company. We brought the samples on Friday to a local pest control company. On Saturday, I received confirmation from their entomologist that the two specimens were in fact bed bugs. Outbreaks in schools and businesses are very, very rare. Bed bugs need human blood to survive, and they're most active at night and are able to do their thing when people are sleeping. So following the discovery of the bed bugs, we've continued to thoroughly clean those classrooms. We've created plastic lockers by having the kiddos, all the students in those rooms, put their backpacks, lunch boxes in plastic bags. We've sent three letters home to families, and we're currently working with the family to have a professional cleaning job done to help remove and eradicate the issue. As far as after doing some research, Nurse Jeannie, she reached out to our district nurse, head nurse, the head nurse for Western Massachusetts, and found that there were similar cases in the past in the Greenfield Public Schools and then some other schools out closer to Boston. It's not common for bed bugs to be found in schools. So it was a new experience for our district. I believe it was the first time any school in the district has dealt with a situation like this. Bed bugs specifically. Okay.
Bed lice, bed bugs, you know.
Yeah.
Elementary school.
Yeah. Yep.
But not fun.
Okay. No, it's we've learned a lot from the whole process. So I think although it's been, you know, somewhat of a nuisance for, and our teachers have been great and very patient throughout the whole thing. I think just going forward, you know, when we followed the specific EPA guidelines for how to deal with bed bugs in schools, and now we know, you know, a lot of the research was honestly done on the spot because it was new to our school nurse who's been doing this for many, many years. So.
He did a great job. Ben kept all the parents informed, all the parents involved informed, and we can honestly say, to the best of our ability and to the, you know, to the most of our knowledge, the school is not in harm's way at all, and the other students are not in harm's way. This is not some kind of epidemic that will affect anyone outside of the family. The family is dealing with it, and Ben and the nurse, Nurse Jeannie, have been great about empowering this family to get the kind of services they need and the help they need to address this, so that it will nip it at the bud. So, great job.
And since the discovery of the two bugs on Thursday, we haven't seen anything else out there on the side. And finally, just on the back of your sheet there, we have a PTO meeting tomorrow night. And tomorrow during the day, we have a district-wide safety meeting. The past 5 years, we've done a walk and roll to school day in the spring. It's been so successful that we have another event taking place this coming Thursday for walk and roll to school day. There's the Farmy Fresh and Fun Fair on Saturday, October 1st. Open houses on the 4th, and some Cafe Suns. And a few years ago, we had the Berkshire Hills Music Academy come in for a performance, and they're coming back this year.
And what is Cafe Sun?
Cafe Sun is a time when students sing or dance or do skits during lunch.
Oh, okay.
And Cafe Sun Set is when they do it at night.
Oh, okay.
Yes.
I love it.
I haven't performed yet.
That's
choice.
They sign up.
They sign up by choice.
Mandatory.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah.
Oh, so they, like a talent child, they can sign up?
Oh, yes.
Oh, I love it.
Well, if a kid pulls me in, I will, but I'm not going to be doing a solo act.
Rich, thanks, man.
Thank you.
Here.
Again, I'd like to thank you for inviting me to represent your district as a superintendent. It's a real honor, and I'm enjoying myself immensely. It's been wonderful. It's so funny because the thought that's constantly in my head is that a bad day here is better than, you know, a good day somewhere else. I mean, this is a really great place to be, and Ben is a wonderful resource. We're just really lucky. So I keep saying this. I'm not sure this is a grammatically correct sentence, but it was a wonderfully smooth opening district-wide. Having that extra week, I felt like the students were even more ready to come in, because I came to Sunderland the second day of school, and those students were already, they were in the lines, they knew where they were going, they knew the routines, and you know, they were just excellent listeners. I watched the music teacher, show the students different brass instruments, and they were just all engaged and listening, and I just felt that they were ready to come back and ready to just get into it. And so anyway, it was a wonderful opening, and I'm really pleased to see that. And oh my goodness, this is not the right report. Okay, how about just put those aside and I'll read you Sunderland's. I just happen to have it right here. What I wanted to tell you is we have, I've been invited to we have a lot of meetings that we go to. So Sunderland says, I have been invited to attend the Sunderland Town Select Board meeting on Monday, October 17th at 6:30. My understanding is that they would like to discuss the central office move to Frontier Regional School. So I would, first of all, I'll answer any questions that you have, and secondly, if any of you are free that night and want to go, that would be great.
October 17th?
October 17th.
Monday.
At 6:30 at Town Hall. My understanding is, and I don't know for sure, I didn't take the message, but that they'd like to discuss the move to Frontier.
Oh, and you, most of you were at, or if not all of you, were at the August meeting. And just to update you, on Tuesday, a week ago this evening, we did present a budget to Frontier for the move, and they did approve it. And it came from various sources. And one of the things I do want to say about that was, when we had the joint meeting, we had finalized budgets because we didn't know what the committee was going to choose. And I made a comment about, in the best case scenario, I'd have a year to plan. Well, that was just my accountant speak, and I didn't want to, and I think it was misconstrued that the superintendent was not prepared with budgets. And that's not true, and I want to publicly apologize to Dr. Carey if that was how it was interpreted, because that's not how it was meant. That was just my accountant speak. In a perfect world, we want everything a year in advance. But we were working on budgets, and we just didn't know what they were going to select. And it was a Frontier decision on the monetary, so we weren't going to address it at that meeting. So we did bring the budget to them on Tuesday evening and a week ago this evening, and they did approve that, and we will be moving forward with our plans to move to Frontier. Hopefully, we're targeting the week after Christmas for the actual physical move.
Thank you, Patty. Yeah, when all was said and done, and we looked at the different scenarios, we had a scenario in Waitley at Sandy Lane, and we had the scenario staying where we are, and then moving into Frontier. And all things being equal, the most cost effective and the most reasonable choice was actually moving to Frontier. There was 4,500 square feet available at Frontier. Sandy Lane was only 25 or 2,600 square feet. The cost to bring Waitley Christian Lane up to code was bordering around $400,000 because of the need for an elevator or a way to make it ADA accessible, to make it fire safe with a sprinkler system, to get all those fire doors opened and usable, and also to prepare for the eventual, which we're expecting anytime soon, the boiler to just kind of end its life. The boiler is encased in asbestos, and there's also the air quality, particularly in the cellar where some people do have their offices. So there were a lot of reasons. The decision to move was made before I came to the district. We had essentially two choices. One was Waitley, Sandy Lane. It was a warehouse. It was the interior of a warehouse that I just didn't feel would be appropriate for our accounting people. And it would be probably about $24,000 a year would cost, plus the build out cost, which we would have to take a loan for to build that out. Whereas we can move into to Frontier for roughly about $60,000, and 20 of that, well, no, not 20 of that.
And again, that's a one-time cost versus a reoccurring cost.
Every year, it wouldn't cost us anything to stay there. Also, too, with us moving there, Frontier also needs a new phone system. There, the switches on their phone system, when they get, to make it simple, when they're being used, all the lines, the switches shut off, but they don't reset themselves, so many times parents are calling the high school and they're getting a busy signal, and it's just because the switches haven't reset. They did a quick fix several years ago, kind of like cobbing it together, but it didn't hold. And right even to last Monday, not yesterday, but a Monday before, they were down again. So it's going to cost $20,000 to do a whole new phone system, which we're going to do in stages. And the first stage is $8,000, and that will set us up too for our phone systems in the high school. So we're using three classrooms that we were able. One was being used by a speech therapist. The other ones were English classroom and history and a special ed classroom. And they were able to move those classrooms upstairs. They're seventh grade classrooms, and they were able to move them upstairs into the seventh grade hallway so that the students didn't have as far to go. The teachers were closer to be able to communicate more rapidly, to stand in the hallway watch. The students don't have, you know, not going up and down the stairs. So there were a lot of pluses, and we're looking forward to it. It's going to change a little bit the way we do business. The cost of keeping Waitley open, the insurance will not be raised, even though we're not in the building. We're going to be using that for at least the next 7 years, we think, for storage, because there are many, 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 many records still there. Many of them have to be just destroyed, but many of them still need to be saved. So it's a large undertaking, and it is going to it's going to be a little hard on some of the office staff, because they rely on where things are and what they're doing, and there's really no time to interrupt their work. So but we're going to persevere and do the best we can, and it really, in the end, it's best for the district. It's going to save us money in the long run. And I personally, and I have said this before, we're an educational organization, and I'd like to be near the students. I'd like to be somewhere in the school. So I move on. If you're available that day, I'd love to.
Basically what she's going to say.
Where physically are you going to be?
Way over by the tennis courts in the middle school entrance. We're going to make that the superintendent's entrance. So there'll be a buzzer, and that's $2,000. So this is how the cost is moving up a little bit. We're not buying new furniture or anything, but we are getting partitions so that even we're using a classroom, but like the four bookkeepers will each have their own corner. They'll have partitions. Special ed will be set up. Bob Lesko will have a place out of school time. And Patty and I will have offices, and so as you walk in, the very last door will be the offices, and then there's a set of double doors, and it says Frontier Regional Middle School, and that will actually be superintendent's office entrance. So way on this. We really won't have any interference, or we won't be interfering with the day-to-day business of the middle school. The classrooms that are down there, be honest, there's maybe two life skills classrooms, which are students who have multiple disabilities, and they're very small classrooms. And then there is one science classroom there, but that, you know, that's just it.
My superintendent's office is housed in the middle school, and there's no issues or problems.
Yeah, we have so much to do. It's a model that is an AFA, it's an Orange, it's Mohawk, it's pretty much everywhere because it is cost effective. But and it's where I came from too. But I think that once we get there and all is said and done, after a couple of months, they're going to be happier. They're going to be very happy because it's lighter, it's cleaner, it's fresher, it's ADA compliant, fire safe. We're following all the laws, and so.
Now we're going to have fireworks.
You get to visit classrooms now?
Yeah, well, I do anyway. I mean, I do come out. I still plan on being in all the elementary schools once a week. I mean, I'm not going to just stay there. I like the little ones.
If I were to anticipate, you've been to, you know, work with our select board for a number of years now, you know, what they would ask, which was the same kinds of questions I think you kind of have covered, you know, is that there's a short-term cost, which there were going to be short-term costs anyway, and then how that compares to the longer term. And then the only kind of the remaining question is then, is that longer term is sustainable in that building, which again, we addressed and Darius seemed to be comfortable with the decision given the overall demographics for Frontier, not expecting that losing that space was gonna be
foreseeable,
a problem for the school in the foreseeable future. So then the longer term numbers are particularly compelling since the rent there is a good deal.
Yes, the rent, the electricity, the insurance, it's all kind of already taken care of.
So I would guess that they're going to be supportive of the move, but I don't want to speak for them.
But that's the thing, in the meeting, it's like, if the bank called me up and said, you know, if you can make a double car payment this month, we'll just call the loan even.
Right.
I would want to jump on that.
Right.
And it feels kind of what it was like. And so we don't want to put a gun to their head and say, you have to take this deal. But it feels like that may be approved. Darius moving some stuff around so the deal is still on the table.
Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah. And that's why we called the meeting in August. In May, they had developed a subcommittee to look into it. And then they reported back, and then in June they said, keep on with the subcommittee. Well, we had really, the subcommittee, we worked really hard in July when I got on board, and we really decided that this was the best for a lot of reasons. And I had a PowerPoint, and I had a show, and all this. So we wanted to bring it as soon as possible to the all the schools, all the committees, so that they knew, and also too, so we could get permission. Because even though we're not moving, there was no rush for us to move over there, and there were so many things. Students always come first. But Darius did need to, you know, move those three classrooms up onto the seventh floor hallway to make room, and he needed that approval to let him do that. And that was the first step of, so we asked, and I think there was one or two people there that weren't ready to make that decision, but it did get passed. But looking back on it, I do have to say it's the best decision for the district. It really is. And I'm glad they made the decision. We went back to the drawing board. We started out, well, maybe 97,000 would be great. Well, no, we've got it down to 60,000, and that's really more than what we're talking about. The phone system's expensive, the air conditioning's expensive, the movers are probably going to be expensive because we're not buying new furniture. So those are our three big expenses. But the infrastructure's there, the wireless or the internet drops, the electricity, we have to do a little bit of that. But we cut it down so we won't be spending as much as we anticipated originally. Thank you. I've been busy completing my interviews. I was able to interview most of you, and thank you for coming and spending the time with me. I'm going to be reporting on those interviews and how they went. But essentially, people were so positive and so invested in this district. It was a wonderful experience, and I'm going to report on that in October. I hope I'll be ready, and then to lay out kind of what my entry plan will look like. I'm not exactly ready. I'm still asking a lot of questions. I think people are, every once in a while, they get a little nervous or defensive because I'm asking questions, but just so that I know, you know, and I'm looking at the traditions, and I'm looking at the way, you know, we've always done things, and what people are used to, and most of the time it makes perfect sense to me. Every once in a while I have to say, just because we always did it that way, it doesn't mean it's right. You know, we might need to, you know, look at maybe perhaps doing it another way. But it's a well-run district, and couldn't have asked for a better district. So the MASC, the MASS Joint Conference, is going to be held on Cape Cod November 2nd to the 5th. And I'll talk to Donna tomorrow to see if she can make a reservation for you if it's not too late.
Okay.
So if you do have that Wednesday available. that would be, right?
Yeah, actually it would work a little better because I ended up getting a wedding that Saturday.
Oh, okay.
So I was going to go Thursday to Saturday. Uh-huh. And now if I flipped it from Wednesday to Friday, then that actually would work better. And I can't imagine the cost would be different. It's the same amount of time.
Right.
So,
great.
I think it should be okay.
So even though I can't believe I got confused on my your notes. It's the IT Power School. If you look at the bottom, it's the same for everyone. And we have made the integration with Power School, our information system. It has been going on all summer. And I have to tell you, our IT people, especially Scott Paul, he leads a great crew of guys and females, and they've worked really hard on taking the information from Redeker and actually integrating it onto PowerSchool. Do you have PowerSchool, Kevin?
Yes.
Any others? Sure. Most of the districts I've worked at have had PowerSchool. So coming here, I was so glad I didn't have to go kind of backwards into the dark ages or the old days to go, you know, back to Redeker. But PowerSchool is what most schools in this country use. It's pretty intuitive. It's got the employee accounts, the students' accounts. It's got gradebook. The teachers can go in on gradebook every 2 weeks or so and change the gradebook. It interfaces to make the report cards. We've got a nursing interface, Snap, with it. We have School Messenger. I will probably be using that when I call you at your homes and tell you that school is canceled because of snow. And it's also going to sync with eventually with our library management system. So I'm really excited about it. I feel it was a good move. And I was very fortunate to come here because this district uses my learning plan for our evaluations and for our professional development. I'm very familiar with that. We use ASAP for our substitutes. That when we call in sick, we put it in ASAP. You can put your lesson plans in it, and then a substitute can pick. It's all done online. I'm very familiar with that. Infinite Visions that Patty uses, Budget Sense, I'm very familiar with that. And so Power School just was really the, you know, the cherry on the ice cream sundae because it just was, talk about integrating, you know, I just sink right in because also too, our mail, Gmail, whatever it is.
Google Docs.
Yeah, and so it was a very easy transition for me. And that's all I have. Thank you.
Thank you.
Sorry about that.
Yeah.
It's a rookie mistake. I can't believe I did it. I know why. I really thought that tonight was Chandler, and Thursday was Sunderland, and I don't know why I had that.
It makes you feel any better. Superintendent Barrett used to do the same thing.
See that? I couldn't ask for a better company.
Right. I meant to, at the beginning, to wave and see if, you know, Marty was out there watching from her couch.
She's doing something
better. Something better out dancing or something. Whatever. All right, I think that is it for our agenda. We have a motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn.
All right, second.
Second.
All in favor? Yes. Thanks.